Hello and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production between the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt from the Bowen Center, your host for Family Matters. Through this series, you will hear from people who have had experience in helping families with a variety of relationship issues. Each one will bring a special perspective to the subject under consideration. Today, I'm privileged to have once again as my guest, Dr. Roberta Gilbert, who is on the faculty of the Georgetown Family Center, now known as the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family. Dr. Gilbert's first book, Extraordinary Relationships, was published in 1992 and has been going strong ever since. This volume was followed by Connecting with Our Children, Guiding Principles for Parents in a Troubled World, and in 2004, she published 8 Concepts of Bowen Theory. Her new book, Extraordinary Leadership, is expected to be out soon. In addition to a faculty appointment at the Family Center, Dr. Gilbert is in private practice and conducts ongoing leadership seminars for clergy in Virginia. Welcome back, Dr. Gilbert.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Well, when we talked before, we talked about extraordinary relationships sort of in broad brush.
Yes.
And there was interest in people thinking about how these ideas would apply in a work system. And I think just about everybody has some version of a work system. And there are tremendous challenges for anybody who is working. And how do you keep the relationship system going well? How do you get the work done? And all of issues that how they interact with each other. So I'm glad you could be back with us for this segment to discuss extraordinary relationships in the workplace.
Well, you know, in the beginning of the book, I said, if it isn't love that makes the world go round, it is relationships. Relationships do make the world go round. And certainly in the workplace, if relationships are not functioning well or functioning smoothly, then a whole lot of energy has to go into that that could be given to the product or to the work, to the output of the workplace. And so we find in a lot of workplaces that, that the place is just simply bogged down in a lot of relationship stuff. And people really have no guidelines, they have no way of getting up out of it. And so what we found early on, we found that what worked in the family, the guidelines that worked in the family, had a direct applicability in the workplace. That people who spend a certain amount of time together will also form an emotional unit similar to the way the family does. Maybe not exactly the same, and maybe not quite as intense, but very similar in some ways.
Well, so, everybody brings whatever is unresolved in their own family to the workplace.
Exactly.
And they play it out in that arena also.
Exactly. We all bring who we are into our workplace because
right.
we spend a lot of hours there.
Right.
And we can't help it.
We can't help it.
We have to bring whoever we are into it. And so we do. And it may be very positive, and it may be sometimes rather negative. So what we learned was that these same guidelines about not viewing the anxiety or the upset or the relationship problem around in the family, we learned that that's very useful in the workplace too. If I can work on my own anxiety, get myself calmed down, go there, do my work, I'm much more valuable as a worker than if I go there and spew all of my anxiety around to everybody about this or that, whatever form it may take. Then I'm disruptive to the workplace.
How do you then know what is a legitimate concern to be expressed versus one that is not? Do you have any thoughts about that, the guidelines on that one?
Yes, it's people often ask that. Is it me or is it them? Do I have a beef here or don't I? Or do I need to work on myself? And I usually think, you know, I always need to work on myself. Because even if I'm being mistreated or mishandled in some way, still, a lot depends on how I respond to that. And so if I can get a little objective, start thinking instead of just emoting all the time, but I can start thinking according to some of the guidelines, I'll do better with whatever comes my way.
I guess my question, I was thinking about I was a consultant years ago in an organization and had a conference with the boss one day. And we were talking about an issue that had emerged way down at the very bottom rung of the organization. And he said, if I had known about this 6 months ago, it could have been handled with a phone call. But he said, it festered and the worker at that level didn't want anybody to know how bad the problem was. So they dealt with it for like 6 to 8 months until it festered and got worse and worse. And then she reported it to her supervisor, who also messed with it for another 6 to 8 months trying to get it right. And he went through the whole chain, and he says, by the time it got to me, God himself would not be able to handle it because it had incorporated, here I'm going to talk about triangles, it had incorporated how many other agencies in town. So that's kind of how I was thinking about this whole thing of being a responsible worker in a larger system, and the difference between personal feelings and what it is that needs to be communicated in a work system that helps to keep the place viable versus your own personal, whatever it is that you can spew into an agency that just deadens everybody, that is so relationship oriented.
Right, and our natural tendency as human beings is when we're upset or when we have a relationship problem to go and tell somebody else about it. And they in turn will tell somebody else, and other agencies, as you rightly point out, can get involved in all of this. And so the triangles form. And right, when that starts to happen, the whole workplace can be a big hubbub of emotional stuff, and very little work can get done sometimes. So I don't know what he would have done had he known earlier about this, but he seems to, sounds from the way you tell the story that he might have had some way of dealing with it early that would have prevented all the triangles from happening quite as intensely.
Right.
The triangles, of course, are always there.
Well, I think triangles sound to me like they're one of the primary mechanisms that workplaces use
Exactly.
for displacing anxiety. And can you describe a little bit about how that operates? What's the linkage here and how that operates?
I think we can describe it. We don't know why for any of these patterns, but we know that if two people are interacting and they suddenly have a problem, one of the very first things they'll do is to turn to someone else and say, well, what do you think? Or someone will come in from the outside and try to solve it, or be just interested. Did you ever go to a conference and have an intense conversation with somebody in the hallway? It doesn't last very long before somebody else comes in and wants to be in on it too. It's just a human phenomenon, this thing of triangles. And so in the workplace, you know, the water cooler phenomenon, they just start to grow.
Well, is gossip a piece of that?
I would think. Talking about the boss when the boss is not there. gossiping. Right, all of that.
People do this for a purpose, and the purpose of gossip is what?
Well, I think it varies with the situation, but very often they're trying to come from an outside position to a more inside position. So if I can set somebody against their best friend, then I get to be the best friend, is our twisted reasoning, I guess.
You and I can be close as long as we're talking about that third person out there that and, we both agree there, is not who they should be.
And there's that, right. Yeah. So the triangles are always vying for position. They're always, someone's always trying to come in closer, and someone's always on the outside. Where I see it the most commonly, of course, I work mostly with clergy these days, and the clergy will describe stories of how a whole congregation will, the triangles will form on this side and the triangles will form on this side of an issue. An issue will get attached to these triangles. And it can actually split a congregation when that goes on, when the triangles become blue and red or polarized in some way.
Well, our whole society has gone that direction. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just so easy now for anything to get into the polarity. Mm-hmm. And then even a minimal amount of information about what do you do with polarities would
and people say,
helpful. I
unthinkingly, they'll join a side. Just emotionally, they'll join a side, really not thinking through what it is they really think. So that, I think, is one of the antidotes to all of this, is when one person in the whole group can start thinking and think about the real issue. What is the real anxiety here? Usually the real anxiety isn't what people think they're anxious about. It's usually something more basic.
Such as?
Such as in the denominations, the numbers falling off. The denominations, right, many of the denominations right
well,
now
that,
are shrinking.
That sounds like that, in summary, that gets to be some kind of a survival issue.
Exactly.
The issue of survival.
Exactly.
Will
so,
we survive?
Exactly. So when you get to survival, you would rather not, it's something people are so scared of, they really don't want to talk about that. So, but they're very anxious, and so they'll attach it to any number of other issues. Attach that anxiety to and those triangles to any number of other issues, and never really get to what's really bothering them. So it's interesting to listen as people tell the stories about this. One church that I was privileged to hear about almost split because one mother. One mother's 18-month-old did not get to be the baby Jesus in the Christmas play.
Now, I would say that was a place that had other issues.
And they did. They had other issues.
Right.
But they weren't getting to them. And so these other more superficial issues seemed like the end of the world. Who was going to be the baby Jesus? Seemed like the end of the world. But there were really others that they needed to get to.
Stuff like that goes on in marriages also, where people will start fighting over the dishes in the sink, and nobody really cares about the dishes in the sink. But just leaving a dish in the sink is a declaration of war.
Right.
Unless one person can say, hold on 1 minute.
And you'll hear it at workplaces, the same thing.
What is the issue behind the issue? What's going on here? And be able to call it.
Right. And quite often it has to do with leadership. Very often the leadership relationships aren't working too well. And when they start to work well, or the leadership may be as somewhat distant, and the leadership will start making more contact with these triangles, you'll see all these issues will just melt away. It's very interesting. You see that same dishes in the sink issue in workplaces too. I think we've all seen that. I've heard it 100 times. You know, dishes in the sink, and they're about to fire me.
It's like a barometer of the anxiety.
Exactly.
Of how high is the anxiety in this organization. And I think most organizations probably have some issue like that. Who left the whatever, you know, who left the paper in the Xerox machine bunched up and didn't take care of it or whatever.
Right. And actually that may be a symptom of poor relationships, when people start not attending to their environment. You know, they may be really so upset about what's happening relationship-wise that they're a little sloppy or they're a little inattentive. But then that becomes the issue instead of what's behind it. So it's interesting.
What is the best antidote for triangles? if you live in them.
Talking to them, I think.
What does that mean?
Well, in the case of the church that almost split, when I heard the whole story, that the pastor had been gone a lot. She'd had a lot of deaths in her family and other things. And I thought that if she would start making contact with various key people in these triangles, that it would make a huge difference, that she'd been just a little bit absent and hadn't found a way to make contact while she was absent. So she did that.
That would decrease the negativity coming her way about her?
About her and about the whole thing.
Okay. It had spilled over. It had gone from her as the problem into all these other relationship issues.
Right. And it's like when the leader is not present and accounted for, the organization doesn't do well. And it'll take various forms. This is the form that one took. And so when she began to make more contact, and I've seen this in several congregations, the whole thing was over. And they moved on, interestingly enough, they moved on from these seemingly silly issues to real issues that had been chronically a problem. They had been in arrears in what they owed the larger denomination for many, many years. They got that all paid off and cleared up. They did a lot of very interesting pulling up in their functioning.
A minute ago, you talked about being in contact, and I'm assuming that's emotional contact. How do you know when you're in emotional contact with another person? Because people yak at each other all the time and think they're in emotional contact. And then the other one, and they may or may not be. So what would be the criteria of being in solid emotional contact, and how would you ever know?
I don't know how you would know, but you know. People know.
there's an interesting idea.
People know when they're in contact and when they're not.
You can't get more specific about it than that, can you?
Not without getting overly concrete about it. How do you know? How do you think about it?
Well, I don't. It's been one of my favorite questions over the years, mm-hmm. is because it's a very elusive concept. And I would agree with you. You do know when you're in contact with people. And you sure as heck, if you've got anything to you at all, you know when you're not in contact with somebody. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But then there is that gray area where people do kid themselves in the pseudo-self, mm-hmm. that they're just doing fine when they're not. That would be the marriage in which the husband walks out the door and the wife would say, well, I never knew there were any problems.
Exactly.
And she probably didn't.
Exactly. Right. And they really weren't in contact.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But when they get in contact, it's amazing what happens.
Well, what would you say are the major ways of surviving the workplace then?
The major ways of surviving the workplace?
And if you're, particularly if you're interested in an extraordinary relationship.
Well, interestingly enough, we often coach families, you know, if you have a problem with your husband or your wife, sometimes it's better not to meet it head on, but to go look into the family you grew up in and go there and start getting better relationships there, paradoxically. And so very often we coach people, well, how about your mother? How long since you've called your mother? Or something like that. How good is your contact with your mother, with your father, with your siblings? They're a little bit easier.
Well, this would operate on the assumption then that you take into the workplace the relationships that you've already had.
It would, and it would operate on the assumption that you, as you change the relationships in your family, you change something very fundamental about self.
Okay.
And you just do
it's
better.
It's like a pogo stick. You are so different that you go into the situation differently.
Exactly.
Leap back into
also, it. Also, I think you have more options. the broader your system becomes and the more it's working for one, the better one does. I just got home from a family birthday, and my tendency is to be a little distant from my family. And so I thought, in our tendency, after a whole weekend together, my father's 95th birthday, would be to kind of distance from each other. So I got on the email right away and thought, my challenge is to stay in contact with my group. Now, as I do this kind of work in my family, my workplace relationship ability, it changes. I just do better. Certainly, there are things in the workplace I can attack with myself and do better too. But that's one way of going about this relationship thing, is to go back into the family I grew up in and work on some things there. Most of us have relationships there that aren't doing too well.
And to work on those.
And that we could work with those. And when we do, it's very life-changing. But general guidelines for the workplace itself, stay in touch with people.
You know, it's interesting to me, people don't think twice about paying money to go to a gym to work out physically. And the work that you're describing sounds like it is a version of gym going, the work would be like gym for your brain and your mind and your
for your life,
you are.
Yeah. For your life functioning. Mm-hmm. I had one pastor say to me, why would I want to go back there? I don't like those people. I don't have anything in common with them. I don't want to go back there. And his question rang in my head for months. And I think I finally figured out the answer to it. But at any rate, the real answer to it is, why do we go back there? Because it's good for us. Sort of like a gym.
Yeah. It's exercising your emotional muscles.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
And then, too, if we do get those relationships working a little better, you know, there's just less anxiety to carry around with us.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very grounding, calming experience to work on those relationships and see them do better. So I could go on and on.
Well, it's interesting. It is, and I think part of the, I was going to use the word magic, and then I thought that is overstating a case here, and I'm not going to use it, but part of the challenge is that for people who have really difficult situations, not unlike what you're talking about, the man who said, why would I ever do such a thing, that to find ways that there can be moderate success even in small incremental ways, that it then begins to make some kind of sense. And the payoff is so good. That's the interesting thing about it. I think if anybody can get a little bit of success with things, it certainly serves as a great inducement for other successes. So.
But this thing we were talking about before of making contact with people, how do you know when you've made contact? Is just so important in the workplace, because I think we can get overwhelmed with our work. Here in Washington, people think nothing of working 50, 60, 80 hour work weeks. And, you know, I don't know that that's really humanly efficient to do that, but a lot of people do it. And
well, it certainly leads to the overworked and underappreciated syndrome.
Exactly. And they can, you know, just really not have time for their relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And the leadership don't take time to sit down and be on the same page or to just really even spend enough time together working things out. And so then they wonder, why doesn't this workplace ever work? Why are people always in a hubbub? Why is everything always a mess emotionally here in this workplace? And of course the leadership is contributing to that, but they don't understand it. They don't understand how they're contributing. So it's interesting to see them, when they realize the importance of making contact, more contact in the organization, how that organization will calm down and get to work and do, be more productive. It's fascinating to watch it.
Well, I have appreciated your thoughts and your ideas that you've contributed to this show and to another show. It's always useful to have people. You have done two shows here on the broad brush of relationships, and I think it sets the stage so nicely for when we're considering other more specific ideas. So I appreciate your contribution to the show, and
good.
Want to thank you for being here.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Please tune in again to Family Matters. Thank you.